is an assistant professor at the University of the Philippines in Diliman, who has been researching platforms, algorithms, and disinformation in Southeast Asia. She also co-heads the Philippine Media Monitoring Laboratory. Good morning, Professor Gao. Welcome to the program.
Good morning, Mike.
All right, Professor Gao. So tomorrow is the deadline for the filing of the statements of contributions and expenditures, or SOSIS, for all the candidates who ran in the recent polls. But you've raised the concern that SOSIS, are, as they are currently configured, are not enough to truly gauge the extent of a candidate's expenses. Why do you think so?
I think, first of all, we have to define what is included in that definition of political spending. Common law rules on political spending have been created post-Marcos Sr. dictatorship. So it's quite old, has been updated since the advent of social media. So that counts on-ground campaigning, broadcast ads like TV ads, for instance, and print media. So often it's, you know, your mainstream media, you know, advertising. But in you know, the 21st century, in 2022, definitely there's more avenue to do political campaigning. And there are often times that you use avenues that are not officially categorized as political ads, such as the use of influencers, although it parallels hiring celebrities, right? And also the use of, you know, disinformation workers, such as trolls, or fake news accounts, for instance. So the idea of political campaigning now is actually quite indistinguishable already with disinformation campaigns. And I think that's a lot overlap between the two, the you know, the mainstream PR work and the dark PR work underground is the ones that, you know, is actually unaccounted for and not included in the definition. So if it's not asked of politicians to report these kinds of, you know, avenues for political campaigning, why would they do so? There's no incentive to report, and there's no disincentive if they keep it off the books.
And also, even if they're required, if there's no penalty for non-reporting or non-disclosure, how would that be effective, though?
The thing is, the COMELEC hasn't defined, you know, what counts political spending in the online space. Interestingly, you know, the formal platforms of Facebook ads, for instance, where you actually pay and run ads and there's regulation around it that's counted. And there are reports earlier in the election that Lenny Robredo, for instance, have spent, you know, is the number one spender on Facebook in terms of political ad campaigning. And in fact, Marcos Jr. did not spend anything. It's zero ad campaign spending. So that's actually one indicator that that Marcos Jr., for instance, and other, you know, candidates out there might be, you know, engaging in underground activity. And I think that this is actually a logical, you know, assumption, because number one, we have to establish that there's really an active effort to hide or to be stealth in the way these political spending are being done. Anecdotal evidence and earlier research from ethnographic work from Jonathan Ong, for instance, and Jason Cabanyes would instruct us that most of these transactions happen informally in DMs, for instance, in, you know, Instagram. It's the payment or cash transfers. There's no receipts. There's no, you know, contracts being given. So there's that, you know, the stealth way that they perform these transactions is, in fact, making it hard for journalists and academics to look for proof that it's paper trail. That's why a lot of the supporters of Marcos Jr., for instance, would always, you know, attack journalists or, you know, criticize researchers that you don't have proof. But the thing is, proof is hard to reach here because it's so hidden. It's undocumented, and additional ways of investigating it might not cut out. So I think that's one of the barriers here. So whatever is declared in the source, actually, you know, I don't know, I'm just speculating here, it might be five times more that's unaccounted for, because there's really no incentive nor disincentive to report these.
And the question we hear, Professor Gao, is, are we able to get the true picture of how much a person or a candidate is spending if we are not able to have proof that these networks do exist? Because you mentioned there were already reports about Marcos benefiting the most in terms of the disinformation online based on studies by several groups. And you also have Vice President Lenny Robredo, the number one target of these attacks. But how do you cross the line from establishing there is this network of disinformation and attributing it to Mr. Marcos and his team? How do you prove such a claim and such an allegation?
Correct. So the first thing we need to say is that right now, the methodologies that researchers have, the investigative journalists have, doesn't really capture, you know, the whole picture, the whole the price tag of political campaigning in the Philippines in these contemporary times. I think that ultimately we need to improve the ways we do research on this. And in fact, you know, it's a secret project for now. But, you know, on the back end, I'm doing some work really establishing the economics of things that are not necessarily captured by COMELEC rules or even, you know, watchdog efforts to track election spending. So that's one, the methods are not there. Second, but even if the methods are not there, we have indicators that can attribute, you know, efforts of this to Marcos Jr., Duterte, for instance, because, you know, they've been engaging in this information work ever since. One of the points I want to raise here is that even if the election season is only starting, have started February, Marcos Jr. has been campaigning ever since the end of 2016 or post-election back then, because he knew he wanted to run for president. So even, you know, the spending before the actual election is ongoing. There's a machinery being paid for during that. In the administration for as well, we know that troll farms have been institutionalized. In fact, public funding has been funding, you know, these trolls for the longest time and has been embedded in the system of comms and media within the government. So there are indicators of that. In Cambridge Analytica, for instance, there's a whistleblower, and she said that Marcos Jr. really and his family have hired them to do rebranding for them. So there's a lot of signals out there. What I want to emphasize now is that if there's, you know, there's smoke out there, signals, indicators of, you know, shady or underground political work, you would suspect there's fire. And I think we just have to catch up as researchers and journalists in collecting evidence in this.
And so does regulation, right? Because there is the COMELEC resolution that requires social media influencers to report any campaign-related payments, but there is currently no law regulating social media campaign spending. So the dilemma here is, how can you enforce something that's not in the law?
That's correct. And the thing is, as a politician that already won the election, why would I, you know, release things that might, you know, affect my imagery at this point in time? And as I've said also in Twitter, when, you know, this discussion about political spending is happening, a lot of the work, the dirty work, specifically in political campaigning, happens not directly to the, you know, politician. It happens to intermediaries. There are PR agencies doing the work. They don't need to, you know, declare that their client is this politician, because, you know, they might be bonded, or, you know, they might be subjected to an NDA, for instance. So the operations of, you know, dark PR versus traditional industry is quite different. And that's something that the rules have not accounted for. What's interesting is in 2016, this has been happening, you know, at the, you know, very, it's in infancy level, you know, the fake news operator, the troll farms, etc. 2019 midterms, there's already that. The strategies have improved as well, and there's spending attached to that as well. And then the last thing we know now is that, you know, this has matured. There's a whole industry behind it, and it's actually quite hidden in plain sight, because I think that it's an unspoken reality that all politicians engage in some sort of, you know, shadow political campaigning, but by how much and how what scale it is, it's hard to find. So definitely we know anecdotal data. For example, a YouTuber, according to, you know, journalist colleagues, actually paid for 300,000 pesos per month to do campaigning for, you know, politician X. We can get those anecdotal data, but the long road here is building that model from the, you know, those traces of information to having a big picture of political spending in the Philippines. Long road ahead, but we'll try to report back to you on the results of our research, maybe a few months from now.
Mm-hmm. And how important is it, Professor Gao, for COMELEC to be able to include this so-called shadow political campaign in monitoring political spending? How huge an impact do you think social media had in this year's polls? You've had anecdotal evidence, right, discussing, saying that they did this, they did that. But in terms of the impact, can we attribute the 31 million Filipinos who voted for President-elect Bongbong Marcos to just disinformation, to social media influencers? and all of the other, this belong to this network?
The thing is, in the election period, we know that there's campaigning happening on the ground, you know, political work. But the thing is, the work that Marcos Jr., for instance, has been doing in priming the public of how their family have been, you know, victims of a big cover-up by media, international community, the researchers. That whole, you know, pushing of the narratives post-2016 is in fact part of that, you know, opening the minds of Filipinos that, hey, it's actually, you know, noteworthy to consider Marcos Jr. as a president. You know, it's not out of this world to think about that. So, in fact, I would think that because it's, you know, a long-term game for them, it's a long game for Marcos Jr. and for his family to get back, you know, to mainstream politics, that's been ongoing. So this disinformation efforts, is they're not directly attributable, but what I can say is that there are researchers out there who's doing some attribution research, qualitatively at least. For instance, if you've seen those YouTube videos that promote historical denialism or revisionism, people on the ground, voters, when asked if why they prefer Marcos Jr., would say or would echo these narratives. So that's a direct, you know, evidence that these disinformation networks work. Again, the question is by how much. You're right, it's the same question. What's how much impact is it, does it have in the election results? We don't know that. And I think ultimately that's a big challenge we have to fix before the midterm election in 3 years from now, because ultimately it will be weaponized against COMELEC, that this is, you know, uncharted territory, therefore there are no rules, we'll do whatever we want, and it's quite a profitable industry, to be honest. So there's you know, no one's stopping you, no one's penalizing you. Perhaps there's moral ambivalence or dissonance with the workers within the industry. But still, if it would pay well, more than your usual call center jobs, more than your usual advertising job, why not? So there's that regulatory aspect needed to govern the industry, the supply side behind and demand side of the client and the politicians hiring these disinformation and propaganda workers.
And Professor Go, you mentioned a while ago that the so-called historical revisionism has been ongoing since, from your research, 2011. So that's about a decade before the elections. But as a consequence of this, do you think there's a need to actually expand the scope of the SOSE? Because we've had former COMELEC Commissioner George Garcia last week saying that if a candidate withdrew before the start of the campaign period, he does not even have to file a SOSE because he's not technically considered a candidate. So, but given what you said, is there a need to now expand the scope of SOSE to cover years even, not just months before the elections, where there's a clear attempt to promote a particular candidate or a particular family?
It's very hard to answer because we know that elections happen, there's election season that's covered, right? And definitely there's always a limitation to what COMELEC can regulate, can cover during election season. What more if it's, you know, beyond election, before the actual election, where the priming, the agenda setting job is happening. So I think within the election period, let's fix that first, you know, capture what is not accounted for. Something to think about, what if they've been doing this whole propaganda way back before the election. That's something to think about, how to regulate that. But I think we need to think of, you know, elections beyond elections to begin with. For example, one of the biggest factors that Robredo's preference for Robredo is, you know, on a decline versus her performance in 2016 is because there's a two-punch strategy from Duterte and Marcos to discredit her, to, you know, criticize her and, you know, undermine her achievements. And that has been ongoing as well for several years. So it's not just actually promoting one kind, it's also about, you know, mudslinging, disparaging, you know, other political figures out there. There's a lot of things we need to capture here. What counts as negative campaigning, like in the US, right? Negative campaigning still counts as campaigning. So I think we really have to expand what is included in the SOSE, not just the timeline. I'm not sure of the timeline, but I'm sure in terms of the items included, it should be there. And there should be penalties in place to make this, you know, something that's frowned upon, should not be the norm and should be denounced by the institution.
And moving forward, what can be done? Is it enough to amend the scope of the SOSE? Should there be regulation on social media and shadow political campaign? What can we do even with the social media platforms?
Yes. So I think that's two different questions. The first is an institutional intervention question. Mm-hmm. What should COMELEC do? I think COMELEC is well aware of their limitations. I've seen, you know, and read interviews from COMELEC commissioners. They admit that, you know, we cannot capture influencer work who say they do this voluntarily, but in fact are paid for, because why would you be a vlogger and that's going to be your main job if you don't get paid for mm-hmm. what you do, right? There's labor involved in that. So definitely, I'm sure it's paid for, and the market rates in the industry are quite comparable too. So it's not as if we're, you know, in a blank slate here. We have lots of information. It's a matter of putting them together. So I think researchers like us would be open to aiding COMELEC and expanding those definitions, expanding those rules, and what is included to be reported, what should be declared. I think there are other government instruments that could, you know, govern this as well. We have heard of BIR wanting to tax influencers too. So the referrers through, you know, provide receipts. So that's another apparatus that the government can do to ensure a free and fair election. But the thing is, SOSE exists because they want a fair playing field. But the thing is, the playing field isn't fair or equal to begin with. So I think we need to then think of, maybe it's beyond SOSE. Maybe there are instruments we can do to ensure that there are, you know, checks and balances with the spending, especially the shadow political campaigning I've been talking about in the last few minutes, to not necessarily ensure the playing field is equal, because that's never going to happen, but at least, you know, not let billions of pesos be unaccounted for. And, you know, that essentially makes me feel like maybe the election is bought. You know, we don't know if we don't know the price, and therefore that's something that we need to discover soon.
And the other question, what about the social media platforms?
So the thing is, I'm a platform researcher, but at the same time, acknowledge that the platforms have limitations. So I've said before in previous interviews that the platforms do have a responsibility to us, especially that we are a high social media usage, you know, country. We're number one in the world for 6 years now. So we're not a small market. But the thing is, the platforms would again have incentives. So if we think of economics again, does it have incentives to help us to address our problems? A lot of the rules are westernized, like they ban, you know, neo-Nazi content or racist content. We don't have that those here. We have a different kind of, you know, problem here, different kind of political animal working within that system. So I think, you know, the platforms need to really adjust to the Philippine context, the context in the global south, as we call it, you know, the periphery of the world, to really, you know, have meaningful impact. Because right now they say, you know, we want to help, we'll help fund literacy campaign, we'll help, you know, perhaps take down content. But the thing is, they come in too late and too little to do meaningful impact. So perhaps, you know, you're right. Now we're going to that suggestion. COMELEC should also include rules on how the platform should, you know, help in meaningful ways, not just through PR. That, hey, Google is helping, or Facebook is helping, TikTok is doing something. It's not enough. It feels so, you know, so such a, you know, just for show. It's not really doing anything meaningful. And case in point, this is an example. We've raised videos of historical revisionism years ago to YouTube, for instance, but still these influencers are out there, you know, gaining money, gaining profit from YouTube itself, because they're YouTube partners. So even if we report them, even if the evidence is there, maybe the rules again hasn't changed. So again, quite a chicken-and-egg situation. We need to change the definitions first so we can include a lot more in the spectrum of, you know, political tools and apparatuses out there before we can really do meaningful change. So it's, I know we are always asked, what can an individual do? What can we, civil society, do? You can do something, but it's not enough. It should be an institution that would, you know, where the change should happen.
All right. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us this morning, Assistant Professor Fatima Gao.
Thank you, Mike.